I think the most central point of the book is that there has been a politics of emancipation, a revolutionary politics of emancipation that has occurred throughout history and that was present in the struggles against racism in the United States especially. And that it's possible for us to continue to maintain that kind of politics and be committed to it. And I want to show that that's possible and also identify the obstacles to it. Well, you know, there are two levels to this question. One is the question of a kind of analysis of society and history. And in that sense, when we talk about race today, it's very closely related to class, that the contemporary concept of race, the contemporary ideologies of race, they are tied up with class in a way that you can't separate them, because they have to do with the way that different kinds of workers were put into different kinds of categories, that they were put into different hierarchies. It has to do with migration, it has to do with national minorities, and it has to do with the global market. But then there's another aspect to the question, which is a political one, which is there a compatibility between movements against racism and movements against class exploitation? And my point of view, as I was saying before, is that a politics of emancipation encompasses both of them. Well, there was, I think, Trump was a big surprise for so many of us, and, you know, all of the intellectuals in the United States were so convinced, they were absolutely certain that he would lose, and he did not. And it indicated a level of, it indicated that people were not really understanding what was happening in politics, and it indicated that there was a kind of crisis in the political system. But at the same time, there was an exaggerated reaction, as though Trump represented some kind of drastic resurgence of fascism or of the kind of white supremacy of the 19th century and so on. Really, Trump also represented something that is already there in American politics, which is the fact that we are an extremely unequal society, which generates all kinds of irrational forms of politics and all kinds of crises that the left has not figured out how to deal with. The Black Lives Matter movement was a very important movement, and to the extent that we will see how it continues, it was very important because, first of all, it arose actually under Obama and not under Trump, which shows you a little bit of why it's a problem to say Trump was exceptional. In fact, the problem of police violence and racist police violence is something that has been ongoing. And it happened under the first black president. And so the idea that you could simply put, as Amiri Baraka put it, black faces in high places, and that that would solve the problem of racism, that was quite clearly refuted by the Black Lives Matter movement. And it showed that it is possible even today for many young people and many people who have not participated in politics before to mobilize, to go out onto the streets, and to defy authority in a way that most people think is impossible. One issue that I see very much in Europe is the issue of migration, and it's a very different kind of issue from the one in the United States. You know, in the United States, this is a country that was, in a sense, constituted entirely by migration from the beginning, and there is always movement of people across what we see as national borders. But migration in Europe now is both a class issue and a race issue, I think, because there is very powerful xenophobia in Europe. And while Europeans may look at the United States and think we're crazy with people like Trump and so on, I think when you look at the way that migrants are treated here and the way that people think about politics in a way that doesn't take the power and demands of migrants into account, is a serious limit.